Well, education, I feel, presently is of high public interest. I have experienced that a couple of times also these days here in Maribor. Major issues are the knowledge society, the literacy, skills, and key qualifications instead of mechanical learning, facts, and past cultural documents. Announcing and delivering a talk on higher education, for me, per se, says that I am out of the box, out of my usual box. I hope you forgive me that nevertheless I do this step. Being outside, I shall address some relevant educational issues, which I consider as relevant, but which are apparently only part of the full problem. And I am afraid that I must say that I cannot give solutions. And I even do not like to give solutions, because if I gave such solutions, that would mean I am already in another box. And with all the dangers being in the box and being not free to think about. Therefore, the main aim of my talk is to stimulate your own thoughts, your own ideas, by giving you a couple of insights which I think are of importance in the field of education. I shall start with the overview, why I'm so strongly attracted by physics. You will feel that again and again. That means I cannot really forget my box, though I think I am out of the box. I will start, as I said, with science education generally, then with the inner structure of university innovation education, continue with the teacher's education in particular, say a couple of statements to the this case of the teacher's education. We'll then put your attention to the challenge of archiving, which belongs to one of the main problems in education, as you will see. Then I go with you into the ethics and education, and finally close with the free access problems, if I am able to go through everything. If not, Mr. Chairman, please stop me. Then you can read what I was not able to say in the proceedings. The first thesis is that science, doing science, living with science, educates. Let me exemplify this with that science, usually exemplify this with that science which is my own field of interest. As I said already, this is physics. But I feel it also holds for other sciences in the meaning of the word. That means for biology, for chemistry, and I add probably mutatis mutandis also for the humanities and other sciences too. Still, let me consider usually physics as a representative part, though only one part, of course, in the general symphony of education, and I shall think and argue in this reference frame, but you are asked to transfer that to other sciences which you prefer. I better reframe completely or nearly completely from the humanities, since I feel this is clearly beyond my real expertise. So, my statement then is science, or say physics, educates. And let me detail this with a couple of sub-theses. The first one is, education through physics, through sciences, means trust in rational mind and the experience of law. Law which is valid for everything and everybody, valid without exception, and seemingly of lasting validity. Physical and science insights protects our souls against fear and anxiety and lightens ratio explanation and understanding rather than subjecting us to threats by whomsoever. Subtopic 2, education through physics gives the wonderful experience, I always feel the wonderful experience of a truth which can be proven, which can be conveyed to others as simply being true. And what a truth, let me expand on that. It is a truth founded on experiment, on thinking, and on resulting law confirmed by reproducible experience. If you have doubts, you just look it. It is a truth beyond belief, and it is a truth of tolerance. You may believe it or not, it simply is or happens as law says. There's no debate, no quarrel, and that makes its use much easier. It can be refined, it can be further developed. It can be renewed based on new experiment. Without any irrational emotions to keep the old once one recognizes it as not being correct. And it is a truth which always asks you to doubt it. To doubt it even 2 times 2 is 4. We know today there are algebras in which this does not hold. So a truth which asks you always to doubt it, I think, is a wonderful truth. Subtopic 3, physics is a truth which tolerates being incomplete, not knowing or not yet knowing all and everything. All centuries had their who knows in the sciences as well as in other fields in philosophy and so on. Such who knows in physics today are, for example, cosmic mysteries. Dark matter, dark energy, possibly overwhelming, but not yet even seen, though gravitationing. Physics, thus, is a law and a truth which is open for corrections. Ancient Ptolemaic view has changed drastically. Phlogiston and ether have completely vanished from the scene, maybe for a while only. The Big Bang model or idea or description waits for further understanding. So it is incomplete. Physics, and this is my last point concerning the importance of this truth, physics and science are truths which need no defense by intolerance or fanaticism. They need no defense by fundamentalism or even suicide bombing. Isn't science, isn't physics a wonderful truth? Subtopic 4. Education through physics is the experience which was very influential for me personally, and I know of others also. For example, Professor Soller mentioned that also in her talk, that the language of nature is mathematics. This makes the insights and statements in physics and in many other sciences so extremely precise, clear, without the slightest ambiguity. Usually one can't quantify one's statements. Again, very clear, very precise. But nature can be dealt with by mathematics is both, I feel. It is a miracle, but also deeply satisfactory. Or I can also say inversely, it is deeply satisfactory, but it is a miracle. We should think much more about that. Subtopic 5, education through physics rouses our instinct for the new, for being curious, being open-minded, for being innovative. It strengthens our human wishes to create and to design. It enables a responsible life, the participation in modern technical culture. Physics, in fact, is one of the fundaments of our present technologically oriented culture, of our economic welfare and prosperity, and it thus deeply contributes to the modern societies, maybe mankind's total culture. It educates for a life in a culture ignoring national or any other borders between people. It simply says, think yourself. Think yourself. Both is right. Only subject to conscience. It is for these reasons that our young students, male as well as female, are strongly encouraged to study sciences and technical disciplines. They are badly needed in our modern technical culture. And society, I think, and I appeal for, should support them. My second main thesis is that I deal now with the university as a locus of higher education. Besides, of course, the schools, no doubt about, our universities are the main loci of higher education. There is common agreement that universities are places of research. Research is innovation, per se. But there is also common agreement that our young people shall go there for learning. Less agreement is what precisely that means, learning. Let me argue for both. It is learning for their future profession. That means it is training to some extent. But it also should be an intellectual and ethically educated learning. Higher education means to be knowledgeable. It means to own literacy and skills. It is not just mechanical learning. It comprises furthermore personality, faculty of judgment. So we have to do all that at university teaching. Moral and ethic standards, responsibility, empathy, cooperation, open mind, just living in culture. That is the way learning should be. In order to well educate, the duty of our universities is at least twofold. It is teaching and also research. Teaching in the way I just described it, in order to be of value for the students. It is Wilhelm von Humboldt's ingenious idea and great heritage that research and teaching should be a unity. We are knowing this now. Only together they are the basis for education by science. But let me detail this by another, as I feel, very important aspect. Historically, the assignments of a university were more specific. When the Philipps University in Marburg an der Lahn, the partner university of this university in Maribor, was founded in 1527 as the first Protestant university in Germany, the Landgrave needed Protestant priests for the religious and spiritual life of his people. He needed lawyers, of course, for his administration. He needed medical doctors for his own health, for his families and his peoples. Only a small part of the newly founded university was devoted to the arts and philosophy. Nevertheless, it became clear later that this part is the one which led to the greatest fame and reputation of his university. And all this was a privilege then of a very small minority. But today, for a promising future, higher education must be open and should be open to everybody who is able and willing. I feel this is a very important change in the development. In our country, a considerable fraction of our youth visits university looking for good education as well as training for their later jobs. But society also expects and highly needs new ideas, original insights, creative stimulus, and innovation, asking all that from its universities. And this apparently favors research. And due to this emphasis to research, the present modes of funding even strengthen this view that research seems to be something which is most important. But I think we should always remember Wilhelm von Humboldt, never separate research from teaching. As of course, vice versa is also correct. Never do mere teaching without engagement in research. Both belong together very intimately. Teaching is content-wise always influenced and renewed from current research. And research is always stimulated by ideas while teaching, while preparing the teaching. The unity of teaching and research, therefore, innovatively improves our culture of living as is. Good teaching is inspiration, is deep thinking, is understanding. I say this because sometimes the students experience something which does not seem to be this way. It is thinking, is understanding, is explaining, avoiding uncontrolled self-evidences. I personally had various lucky experiences where the students' questions led to fascinating new insight and new original research. A couple of examples I experienced in my life. Let us therefore keep and protect also teaching as an important cornerstone of higher education. In particular, do not allow the time-consuming strategies and working for research grant applications to take over. That's an important problem today. On the other hand, too heavy teaching loads also will not leave enough room for good teaching. Therefore, we need both, as I just described it. Own research, I feel, is always necessary because it somehow confronts us with our own limits. Searching for insight, for understanding and explanation makes us humble with respect to the gift of undeserved success and makes us deeply happy if successful. Such experiences qualify for good, for human teaching, and that's where my vote goes to. For all these reasons, the unity of teaching and research is a signature of good universities, and it is a basis for satisfactory higher education of our students. But, next additional point. Having enthusiastically praised Wilhelm von Humboldt's great idea of the unity of teaching and research, I wish to advance and to advocate for a third partner in this doublet. This third part is learning. Our students also belong to university. Learning should be like research in a field in which you are not knowledgeable yet, but others are already. So in this sense, learning shares research. Learning also is teaching oneself, so it also shares the ideas behind teaching. The students, and I add also the educated scientists, should be educated in this sense of learning. This is the universities, this is our duty to have learning, teaching, and research in this triad. And last to this topic, more recently a new and rather dangerous disease has affected teaching and research and also learning, spreading, I feel, like cancer. All these three basic things in university life may be weakened, and I feel they are increasingly weakened by too many administrative duties and increasing flood of examinations, of evaluations, of accrediting, and of assessing. This affects teaching, as well as learning, by the waste of time at least. But our time is available only once and ought to be devoted to research, teaching, and learning as it is needed for the students and for ourselves. Part and origin, I feel, of this development is the increasing mistrust, and I just say this, is the increasing mistrust by the administration and the resulting over-controlling. This not only is detrimental, since controlling usually, I should say never, does stimulate creativity. For creativity, you need no controlling. It also leads to wrong strategies on the universities. Thus, I appeal, let us go out of the box and come back trusting in higher education again. Originality and creativity do not flourish under complete, ubiquitous administration and permanent control. We appeal to society and politics, protect and keep the unity of free teaching, free research, and free learning for the sake of the sciences, of the universities, and its prospering. Grant your universities with your trust. They will flourish then and reciprocate with rich cultural and economic fruit. My next thesis: engage and appreciate in teachers' education. In introducing the next topic, let me recall that the university departments are not only responsible for the progress in our respective sciences, but also for a modern teacher's education. And allow me to detail at least some of the consequences of this, I think, well-agreed statement. First, the future teachers should learn physics, should learn their sciences in a manner which is oriented towards their future task of education through physics, education through their sciences. They shall educate and inspire all people, not only the future physicists, all young people or their students at school, not only the future physicists or scientists, but also the future lawyers, the nurses, bakers, farmers, politicians, artists, bus drivers, etc. They all should have some insight in what science really is, what physics is. Namely, they all vote for government later on. They are living as responsible members in a modern, technically oriented society and culture. And they should do all this responsibly, and thus should understand what science, what physics is. They are teaching the future layman, the later learned scientists and physicists will go there his or her way anyway. Next subtopic: our still younger kids, we have experienced again and again, are particularly enthusiastic in learning physics. They daily observe various phenomena. They do this on the background of modern everyday life, with television, computer games, and so on. Thus, teachers' training should emphasize curiosity based on that, curious observation, and vivid experiment. From all physics, experiment from all physics, classical and modern, instead of sophisticated, I say this with emphasizing it, instead of sophisticated calculation and abstract thoughts in traditional fields only. Next subtopic: teachers will teach their classes. We have to start somewhere the new circle. Teachers will teach their classes in just the same way in which they themselves have enjoyed or not enjoyed learning at university. Therefore, our lecturing at university should be paradigmatic, being stimulus for the teacher's own future style of teaching, aiming at education through physics, not at doing scientific research. We thus should less emphasize mere exercising and science training in favor of insight, of understanding, and science education, or education by science. Consequently, also the content of the teacher's curriculum has to be oriented on their genuine future task, as it was just described. To professionalize teachers' training, therefore, a curriculum sui generis, a curriculum for its own, has to be offered. This will be different from just being a reduced part of the professional physicist's curriculum. It has to be oriented on their future task. They also have to learn how to educate their young students in school, how to meet the psychological and social problems as well as the background of family and traditions of the young people, to also come to the parents, as we were asked yesterday. My next thesis is, keep our cultural memory. Don't forget the problem, the big problem of archiving. There is an alarming indication that we increasingly suffer from a loss of cultural memory. Whole parts of our present culture as well as cultural traditions seem to simply be forgotten. And higher education produces so many contributions to and lasting credentials of culture, testimonies, arts, poetry, music, etc. The famous poet Adalbert von Chamisso once wrote to his friend Lafoyer, "Verwahre meine Briefe, Briefe sind Archive," meaning, keep or save my letters. Letters are archives. We still have, preserve and admire letters, so many letters, diaries, poems, scientific papers, documents, quarrels, judgments, convictions, travel reports, suggestions, etc., etc. We discuss ancient philosophy. We read Greek and Latin books. We have all those because they have been preserved in some persistent way, mostly in paper, written, or printed. Our wonderful libraries are the loci where we find them, and we should find them in future too. But this is changing somehow, dramatically, in content and form as well as technically. The new cultural entities have become much smaller, but at the same time, they are much more. Instead of books, we have original contributions, we have notes, very small subsets of progress, and communication has gone to the web. We have elusive phone calls, SMS, thousands and millions and even more SMS and mails and files buried for a while on hard disks. But from time to time, we have new computers, or even worse, new software, the older ones being lost. The lifetime of our cultural memory is shrinking. Looking backwards, only a few years, older electronic documents cannot be dealt with anymore. For example, we still know ERN, the European Academic Research Network. Some of us will. Most of us will not, I guess. Or new software may be incompatible with the old one. Old might mean less than a decade or so. I still have folders full of files stored on my laptop, which I cannot open and read anymore due to update changes. The electronic life of higher education has become short-ranged in time. Even on an individual's time scale, it is short. And the more so, in comparison to the long-lasting memory of our historical libraries with their written or printed hardware. As for the libraries, by the way, their task apparently also is changing. We usually visit them only virtually, what a pity, via screens of our laptops, asking for the electronic journal library or eDoc service. Since the libraries have to match modern IT culture, they also are hit by the dramatic loss of memory. We have to notice that and to take care of that. The libraries can do their role in education, participating in the general education, only if they take care of that. I personally consider the fast loss of cultural memory as a kind of modern equivalent to the famous big fire which destroyed the largest ancient library in Egyptian Alexandria. An appreciable part of human heritage was lost then forever. In contrast, and fortunately enough, the modern threat of losing long-time memory might still be avoided. It might still be avoided. But this puts a huge task on the stage. How can we counteract? how properly archive the products, the documents, testimonies of our present electronic culture? And even more important, what shall we archive? Also, all mails, all short messages. If you have ever read, for example, Bertolt Brecht's notebooks, the old version of our folders. If you have ever read that or have read in Immanuel Kant's manuscripts of his lecture notes or his philosophical books, full of corrections, of overwritings on the margin, then you feel how important it is to have the original material available. It allows viewing the roots of ideas, of creative processes in our culture. As far as I can see, and I'm aware of a couple of groups dealing with this problem, there is no commonly agreed solution of these two major problems, namely, what to archive and how to archive. Our present e-culture is still without memory. Shall we really accept that, is my question. I consider it a major out-of-the-box task to develop ideas for saving our culture from death by dementia. This big challenge apparently needs international efforts. Society and governments and we as scientists, of course, must act. Unfortunately, this huge problem presently does not even seem to have been fully realized. Therefore, my appeal, let us jump out of the box and work on safeguarding our higher education's memory. Fifth thesis, higher education creates ethical rules. Ethics, I think, emanate from higher education, also from higher education. Educated women and men are absolutely honest. Their statements are true to the best of their knowledge. Their actions are reliable. In a research group, for example, one shares ideas, insights, results, data, etc., and no one uses that without the other's agreement. Although this is not fenced by law and mostly not even touched by law, ethical integrity is a self-evident, a generally accepted natural rule in higher educated life. We simply take integrity and honesty as is, as a signature, characteristic signature, feature of cultural life, created by higher education. But higher education also is part of general social life, is no isolated paradise. Thus, misconduct may happen. We meet with plagiarism, with forgery, fraud, fabrication of data, and the like. All this seems to be amplified by our modern style of intense competition and economized values. Apparently, misconduct is particularly disastrous in scientific life, thus in our universities and research institutes. However, these have counteracted, and I think I should address that shortly, briefly. They have established, or should do so if not yet, rules and barriers to safeguard the ethics of higher education. As an example, I refer to the codes of conduct of the German research community, the DFG. These codes have been established in the late 1990s, prompted by an extreme case of misconduct, and further developed until present. As stated in that DFG memorandum, the conduct of science is founded on basic principles, valid in all countries and in all scientific disciplines. The first is honesty. Honesty towards oneself and towards others. Honesty, and I add fidelity, is both an ethical principle and the basis for the rules of scientific practice. And I add also for higher education, the details of which differ by discipline. DFG's codified rules of good, honest, fair scientific practice include observing professional standards, documenting results, consistently questioning one's own findings, practicing strong honesty with regard to the contributions of partners, competitors, and in particular also for predecessors. Cooperation and leadership responsibility in working groups, very, very important. We have experiences. Mentorship for young scientists and scholars. Securing and storing of scientific data, here it is again. And strictly honesty in scientific publications. Doesn't all this well describe higher educated life quite generally, I ask you? And don't we wish to have it mutatis mutandis everywhere as generally valid rules against abuse and misconduct, as a request for integrity in all social, all political life too? Higher education in this sense, I think, is the wonderful nucleus of our prospering, peaceful living. To highlight these principles by one typical and representative example, I quote the DFG recommendation devoted to authorship, because the experience is that this is a most often addressed, not easy problem. Its basic principle is that claiming credits for a publication is inevitably connected with sharing responsibility for this publication. The recommendation, the DFG recommendation, says authors of scientific publications are always jointly responsible for their content. A so-called honorary authorship is inadmissible. And what it includes is she or he who did contribute significantly and can share responsibility should or must be an author. How can one disclose abuse and misconduct or even prevent it? The DFG introduced the ombudsman. The ombudsman has some responsibility for advice and assisting scientists and scholars in questions of good scientific practice. And this model was developed further, and today there are no grants, no funds which are given to the universities unless they have the institution of an ombudsman. Without this institution and the rules for its working, this university is not granted anymore. Now, I would have said a few words to my last thesis now, the higher education needs free communication. I'm not so sure if I am allowed to do this or... Okay. An essential part of higher education is free communication. It is a freedom to express one's thoughts, ideas, and opinions, and to share them with any other who wants to take part in that. The modes of communication have changed in the course of time. More than 560 years ago, a huge invention happened with Gutenberg's invention of the printing press. At present, we experience another revolution of comparable importance, which is the IT transition, I call it. We are distinguished of being contemporary witnesses of it. Particularly distinguishing. And revolution brings big evolvements. When printing took over, it were the many monks in their monasteries, hand-copying books and letters, who lost this long-standing task, which was exceedingly important for the medieval spread of culture. Without that, I think we wouldn't have that. It is not yet clear which lasting changes the present revolution of communication will have, but quite apparently, significant changes of the print media's role are already noticeable. Still, there are and will be necessary for public as well as private ones. We simply don't want to look always and glance always on the computer screen. And they are still needed, let me add that, they are still needed today for reliable archiving of the testimonies of our culture and for higher education. But equally apparent are the significant changes. In the age of Twitter and Facebook, etc., there are two main media whose future role in the IT world has to be established new. These are first the newspapers and magazines, and second the scholarly scientific journals as well as textbooks. Literature, at least at present, as far as I can see, seems to be less touched by this development. There are sometimes dramatic losses of subscriptions and of everyday buyers, even of major newspapers, forcing them to develop new strategies of catching public interest. Since they are part of our freedom of communication, of opinions, of thinking, we should engage for preserving them, perhaps in a new look. The scholarly print journals are under debate for specific other reasons, which are important for all of us. I am not addressing original work of artists, musicians, poets, but rather the taxpayer-alimented research publications. Scientific journals have enough authors as well as sufficient large audience eager to read, if they have access. If we don't have access, we don't take notice of that. Citations of papers without access are apparently less addressed and cited in newspapers. The scientific community is growing worldwide with an impressive rate, enhancing the output, but it seems to have mainly led to an increase of the publishers' profits, and we have to address that, which simultaneously their site typesetting services has been reduced considerably. It is a community itself, it's we, which today writes the tech manuscripts, produces the EPS files for the figures, and delivers ready-to-print PDF files. The community also serves in reviewing and keeping the quality and readability free of any charge for the publishers. And after all that, the community has to buy back its own scientific work via its libraries. And this is with dramatically increasing expenses, which are no longer met by the decreasing available funds. The arising problems recently culminated in the mathematics community's Elsevier boycott. The mathematicians are no longer willing to accept the harvesting of excessive profits for values which have been created by others, have been refereed and kept high level by others by selling them back to the originators and creators for whom they got it for free. You may ask, and I think I should address that, you may ask, why do we scientists still publish in profit-oriented journals at all? Because we are able to spread our information. If you discuss this, there's increasing agreement that this is less motivated by dissemination wants of our results, but more by the prestige and high esteem we wish to gain. Let me state it freely and in this way. It is also our response, of course, to recent trend to control and measure our activities, justifying grants and career. Thus, strange enough, we even accept losing our copyright for free and forever. And if you need it again, it's hard to get it back. Of course, I think also in the IT age, the organization of refereeing, of reproducible storing, archiving, and the dissemination of scholarly publications cannot be provided for free. Strictly speaking, the idea of free open access does not fully meet the problem, however appealing it is. Several models as near as possible to this idea are presently in discussion or underway of trial. Green Road and something like that. Apparently, it is a major out-of-the-box challenge. How can we organize scholarly publishing effectively and with an appropriate cost-output ratio? How can we do this, keeping the author's rights with them, who were the inventors and originators? And how do we simultaneously guarantee one of higher education's main aims, the free communication and accessibility for everybody? The appeal is to share the efforts to find modern solutions for the sake of all of the educated people and our culture of living. I thank you very much for your kind attention and close with expressing my sincerest gratitude to the organizer who have invited me and given me the opportunity to present my views on aspects of urgent interest in higher education. The miracle higher education not only is a key issue and wonderful part of our lives, but it also most important and indispensable prerequisite of our culture in the past, at present, and in the future. Let us all feel responsible for its prospering and well-being, for our culture of living. And let us solve our present tasks by jumping out of the box several times, as I indicated, for new, for original, and creative solutions in higher education. Thank you very much.